So John is on the faculty from 1954 to 1970. And in 1969, actually 68, he is appointed to a committee to study coeducation at Dartmouth, all male, for its, literally its 200 years, 1769 to 1969. So in the fall of 68, he's on this committee to examine whether Dartmouth should go co-ed. He ends up chairing the committee. He doesn't want to chair the committee, but almost by default, everybody says, you're the bright guy, you should chair this committee. A bunch of other faculty members, they didn't want to chair it. They were happy to be on it, but they could see the lightning rod that the committee could be. So he chairs this committee beginning in late 68 through 69. Preparing their report to the president, to the Board of Trustees in the fall of 69. The president at Dartmouth, who had served from 1952 or 54, or no, actually 1946, John Dickey, John Sloan Dickey, had announced that he would retire, preferably no later than commencement of 1970. He announced that in May, June of 69, but that he would serve maybe that long, but if a successor could be named sooner, he would retire. So the university, the college, Dartmouth, is looking for a new president in the summer, fall of 69. Kemeny, it appears, got nominated by one or more faculty colleagues at Dartmouth. He didn't throw his own hat in the ring, but he was nominated. So in the fall of 69, that search is beginning to get traction. They're beginning to come down to a short list and so forth. And Kemeny's hearing nothing other than what he can kind of pick up on the grapevine as a faculty member through other faculty colleagues, but it's pretty quiet. And he thinks, I'm probably not going to get anywhere in this search. And he had already been looked at by some other colleges and universities to become a president or become a provost, but he had not moved on any of those. And so in December of 1969, he's still an active candidate, but they haven't interviewed him. And he's hearing nothing. And he knows that Dickey wants to get out as quickly as possible. So his report is due in December, and he meets with the Board of Trustees, and I think also an alumni group, in mid-December of 69. It happens to be right around Dartmouth's 200th anniversary, so there's this big weekend celebration. I think they call it Charter Day, you know, of, you know, the trustees are in town, the alumni are in town, it's Charter Day, 200 years of Dartmouth College, and whatnot. And John's presenting on the co-education thing, which was basically saying Dartmouth should go co-ed. He believed Dartmouth should go co-ed. He was a big advocate for it. Everybody knew that, been publicly in favor of it, even before the committee. And so he figures, he says to his wife, this is a death knell for any presidential possibility that I have, because everybody knows that I'm in favor of co-ed, and maybe the place will go co-ed, but they don't want to pick a president who's so out front on this. But he honestly goes through these meetings and whatnot that weekend, and simultaneously ahead of that weekend, they say, we want to interview the board search committee. We want to interview on this weekend. So he's briefing everybody on the coeducation report, and he's having his first official interview on campus as a presidential candidate. Again, comes home to his wife and says, no way, I'll never be their president because of this co-ed thing. Gene Kemeny was a really interesting partner through his entire adult life. Married when he was in a PhD program at Princeton. She, a Smith grad, I think they're married either before she graduates or as she graduates Smith. And Gene said to him, do you remember what Lloyd Brace, the chair of the board, had said to you at a meeting in New York back a while ago? And John looks at her kind of quizzically And she said, Lloyd Brace has a daughter who is a surgeon. Now, this is, you know, 1969. So a female who's become a surgeon, got through med school, becomes a surgeon. And Jean Kemeny says to John, Lloyd says that the hurdles that she had to overcome were incredible and shouldn't have happened. And so she said, you've got a chair of the board that may come down on your side. Don't forget that. So John goes through the interviews, the weekend ends. They get to between Christmas and New Year's, and John and Jean are summoned to New York to meet with Lloyd Brace and I think maybe one other board member, but it may have just been Lloyd Brace. And it's sort of, you know, this is probably about the presidency, but Lloyd Brace didn't say, we're going to offer you the job. It was come to New York. So they come to New York. They're in the Ritz or somewhere, you know. Jean goes out shopping. John goes to meet with the chair of the board, and he's offered the presidency in between December and the Christmas and New Year's, 1969. They decide, you know, he goes home, you know, decides, obviously, I'm going to do this. And then because of John Sloan Dickey, it's like you got to start rapidly. So he's announced as the new president of Dartmouth in mid-January of 1970, and he starts about March 1. So he's got 6 weeks from the official public announcement to his starting in office to get into the transition, meet with Dickey. I mean, you know, he's an active faculty member, so he knew things. So he's inaugurated on March 1, 1970. He is 44 years old. Not quite, he hadn't turned 44. His birthday, I think, is June or July. So he's 43 and change when he becomes president. He's in the presidency for about 2 months and a day, or 2 months and 3 days, when Kent State happens. So the whole country obviously was on tenterhooks because of the war. Now Kent State, prompted by the Nixon incursion into Cambodia and Laos from Vietnam to try to staunch the supply chain and whatnot that was coming in to support the North Vietnamese, campuses explode all over the country. Four students are killed at Kent State. Kemeny is meeting, already planned meetings that day, all day, with various constituencies at Dartmouth to try to figure out before the students are killed at Kent State. There were calls, there were going to be strikes, moratoriums, all this sort of stuff. And Kemeny's trying to figure out what should Dartmouth do. He's had his staff clear his calendar beginning at about 8 o'clock in the morning. He was not a morning person. They cleared his calendar beginning about 8 o'clock in the morning, meetings throughout the day with faculty, other administrators, key student leaders on both sides, pro-war, anti-war students. He wanted to hear it from everybody. Classic Kemeny leadership style. In the middle of the afternoon, early in the afternoon, the four students are killed at Kent State. He's having these meetings. Now the whole thing is amped up because now four students have been killed. And so now the what are we going to do has taken on, you know, even heightened implications. And so Kemeny continues the meetings throughout the afternoon to about 6 o'clock, ends them. He had started his presidency with, I will go on this campus radio station the first, I think it was Monday or whatever, of each month. And I think the Kent State thing happened on a Monday, it might have been a Tuesday, but whatever it was, that night was the night for his May, now his third, you know, open forum over the air on the campus radio station, carried by telephone wires to the campus and, you know, a few people in the local community. So he was scheduled to do that, I think, at 7 o'clock in the evening. Last person in the office is his provost. And he says to his provost, what should I do? I've got to go on the air. I've clearly got to announce something that we're going to do the next couple of days. And Leonard Reeser, his provost, said, I don't know what to tell you, John. You'll figure it out. He walks about a half a block from where the president's office is to where the radio station was, gathers his thoughts, and then gives extemporaneously, and I've seen this transcript, it's about five single-spaced pages of the transcript of his remarks on the campus radio station. He basically preempts. He basically says, Dartmouth is going to have a moratorium on classes for the next week, starting tomorrow. I'm announcing this as president. Presidents have only so many chips to cash. I'm cashing these chips right out of the gate. I will meet with the faculty tomorrow, but this is a done deal. So the faculty can vote however they want to vote to support me or not, but this is what we're going to do. No classes between now and a week from today, which I think was a Monday. So it was like no classes Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. Classes will presumably resume a week from now. We will dedicate the week to discussion about the war and about what we as a campus community should be doing and whatnot. And he literally, now this is extemporaneous, he says there is a minute in the trustees of the college from in the Revolutionary War when they canceled a semester at the beginning of the Revolutionary War. And he said, this is like that. There is a national crisis, and therefore we have to stop normal activity the way they did in 1776 or whatever. You know, Dartmouth 7 years old. He had picked up that minute, you know, from Dartmouth's history. And that's what they did. And then that moratorium essentially led to classes resumed, but it was totally voluntary. Faculty that didn't want to teach the rest of the semester, which in that day had about a month to go into late May, early June. Students who didn't want to attend classes could opt out and figure negotiate ways to complete. So the rest of the spring, there were classes in session, but not mandatory. And Kemeny came out of that week, you know, and here he is again, 2 months into his presidency. And the students are having a, you know, sort of end of the week. It was spring break. It was not spring break, but what they call Green Key weekend, which is their big spring weekend. And the students are going ahead with Green Key weekend. And they had asked him, should we go ahead and have that? And he said, you know, you owe it to yourselves. And so they have this gigantic dance in a field house, and they want Kemeny to come. And he comes, and he speaks very, very briefly. But he basically is sort of like, you know, we've had this week, we're marching on, the issues are not over, but you folks deserve what you're doing, and go ahead and have your dance, have your bands and whatnot. And then he left. And so, you know, the leadership ability to have the students on your side in a moment like that was really pretty remarkable. And also, 2 months into the presidency, 44 years old. So then the presidency is 11 years and change to 1981. He brings coeducation to Dartmouth in 1972. Another moment with the board where he felt like the board would not support the move to coeducation, and he didn't threaten them. He basically said, if we don't go co-ed, I end as president because I can't be the president of this college if it doesn't go co-ed. So he didn't threaten them. It was just he wanted to be very clear that if you decide not to go co-ed, then my presidency ends. I'll go back to teaching or whatever, because he knew that the only way for Dartmouth to maintain its stature was as a co-ed institution. And he was right. And there was another weekend. It was now December of 1972, and the trustees are on campus, and they're deciding, should we go co-ed? There are sparse little minutes from that meeting, unfortunately. There is an outline of remarks that Kemeny made to the board. And basically what he said was exactly that, that in a sense we have no other choice. We need to go co-ed to maintain our stature, and we will grow and change as a co-ed institution. So he led 2 years into his presidency. He leads the move into co-education. They learn from the mistakes that Princeton, Yale, a couple of the schools that had been ahead of them in going co-ed had made. They made their own mistakes, for sure, but they avoided some of the mistakes that those other schools had made. And the first class with Dartmouth women in it arrived in the fall of 1973. So the decision is made in December of 72, 2 years into Kemeny, 2.5 years into Kemeny's presidency, and the first students, co-ed class, arrives in the fall of 73 at Dartmouth College. And then, you know, you can't really fast forward because the whole decade was tumult and turbulence. Four major recessions, one of which in 1973-74 was as bad as anything that we've seen, the 2007-2008 crash, even the COVID crash was not as severe if you look at it statistically, or the 07-08 crash was on par, but job losses, stock market deflation, all of that sort of stuff equal. So he navigates Dartmouth through a major recession, gas lines, you know, oil crisis, heating issues, Dartmouth College, central New Hampshire, cost of oil, I think quadrupled within about, 8 weeks, 9 weeks in 73, 74, somewhere in there. That whole navigating of financial stuff, the issue of can a college president who's a big ideas guy and is leading this college through some just enormous social changes, developmental changes in its student body makeup with the bringing of women, but he also navigated budget finances in a economic, not just national crisis, but a worldwide crisis in 73-74. Dartmouth development with women, not an easy time. There are some people who would argue Dartmouth still today in 2022 has issues with misogyny and whatnot that are bigger, larger than other places, because the heritage and some of those alumni that fought it then are still alive or they've passed on to others. Why did we go co-ed? Why aren't we all male? Etc. So it's certainly better than it was in 1975, 1978, 1980. But Kemeny had to see that whole early transition, bringing women onto the faculty, along with bringing minorities onto the faculty because of what had happened in racial issues in 68, 69, 70, 71, 72. So that entire diversity, inclusion, hiring process at Dartmouth, he oversaw that early stage of that in 1970 to 1981. And a lot of those issues, we could get into some of them in more detail, but some of them were very, very difficult on the campus within the undergraduate student body. Battles, arguments, conservative students, liberal students, progressive students, in the class of 19, arriving in 1978 or 79, and graduating, I think it was in the classes of 81 and 82, people like Laura Ingraham, Dinesh D'Souza, two or three other major conservative movers and shakers, some of whom now as very older adults, you know, in their, you know, 60s themselves, are still on the national stage. And they were undergraduates, and they made life very, very difficult for John Kemeny and for his leadership team and for particularly targeted faculty, many of them women, some of them black, that those very conservative students literally wanted to ride out of town. And then, you know, just folding up, but, you know, it's a very, very quick snapshot. Late in John's presidency, he didn't know that he was going to, he didn't know when he was going to resign. I think he had an idea that he would serve 10 to 11 to 12 years or thereabouts. But in 1979, Three Mile Island happens, and Jimmy Carter selects John Kennedy to chair the Three Mile Island Commission. So while he's still president of Dartmouth, and also John taught, Dartmouth was on year-round quarters, John taught in every quarter, one course, every quarter of his entire presidency. I don't think he did that while he was chairing the Three Mile Island Commission because he was away so much, but he begins chairing the Three Mile Island Commission at the end of April of 1979. And Jimmy Carter says, I want a report in 6 months. And so Kemeny has to, the other commissioners were appointed. He has to meet them. He has to organize them. They have to find office space. He has to hire staff to staff this thing up. And he finishes the report at 2 o'clock in the morning on the day after the six-month deadline. Deadline was at midnight. He finishes the report at 2 o'clock in the morning and transmits it to Carter on what to do about Three Mile Island. And only in the last month, when the crunch was really on to prepare that report, he was half president and half working on the commission, which is to say he was half president and full-time on the commission. In the last month, he went to the board and he said, I've got to have this month off completely from being president. And so his provost became the acting president for about a month or 6 weeks while the report was completed at the end of October of 1979. And then he came back and he was back to being president. And it was in the spring of 1980, 6 months later, 7 months later, that he announced that he would resign at commencement in 1981. And the search for his successor was begun. So, but that's horribly, horribly compressed. There are three or four major episodes that happened after coeducation, some of them sparked by coeducation, some of them sparked by Dartmouth's real wrestling with their quote-unquote Indian symbol, which was never actually a symbol of the college, but that people thought was a symbol, and Kemeny had to navigate all of that with the trustees, essentially to make sure that the Indian symbol was no longer accepted. Even today, 2022, there are people who produce Dartmouth sportswear with Native American symbol on it. It's not the college's symbol. It was essentially outlawed by the Board of Trustees, but you can only control what you can control. And if people offsite are still saying, oh, you're the Dartmouth Indians, what can you do? You keep saying we're the Dartmouth Green. We were never the Dartmouth Indians. But that was also, for 5, 6, 7 years of Kemeny's presidency, something that had to be tremendously navigated with all sorts of internal pushes and pulls, but also external pushes and pulls about Indian symbol. You know, the Indian symbol isn't just the Washington Redskins deciding to become the Washington Commanders in 2022, you know. It was around a lot earlier, and Dartmouth was one of the places that had its own history and culture with it and had to navigate its way. And Kemeny was managed somehow to be on top of that, even though that was an enormously fraught issue. And again, same conservative alumni who didn't like women, they wanted the Indian symbol. They felt that moving away from that tradition, you're moving away from our heritage, et cetera, et cetera. And Kemeny managed to, when I say beat all that, I don't mean that in a feisty or fighting kind of way. He navigated it. He kept dialogue going. He was a teacher and educator throughout his presidency. So people report about his cabinet meetings. They say they were like seminars, not just because we're talking about ideas. He wanted to make sure everybody was heard all the time. And if there was somebody silent for an hour and a quarter in a meeting, he said, Jack, what do you think? Mary, what do you think? You haven't spoken up. And he wanted to make sure that everybody was heard from. And often it was like, okay, we've discussed out an issue. Time out. Next meeting a week from today. I will think about it. You go all home and think about it. And it wasn't, we're going to have the discussion, but we won't make a decision until a week or 2 weeks later so that we can let it settle in and figure out what the best thing to do is. But he always, despite all that, the buck stopped with him. And when he made a decision, he basically, well before Bill Belichick, it was he made a decision and he moved on. And people said he had an incredible ability to make a decision that was against something that he used to stand for and now make it look like he was for it all the time. But that was this notion of Kemeny being sort of ahead of the wave rather than behind the wave. I don't think it's an original comment, but one of the board members early in his presidency said John Kemeny can see around corners. And that notion of I'm walking down a hall, except there's something in this side hall, and I know what it is before I turn the corner, before I get to the intersection. And that was what one of the trustees said about him. Now, I don't think it was an original comment about Kemeny. You know, I think any good leader can see around corners. John Kemeny could see around corners. And so that staying ahead of things, the what to do about the moratoriums, the war. Kent State happens in the middle of the meetings that you're holding that day. What do you do? How do you get ahead of it? He wanted to be ahead of it, not behind it. And that was an absolute moniker of his leadership style that was almost uncanny. I worked there for his last 3 years. So I saw him as a president. Wasn't close to him, not a close confidant. Saw him on the campus. Saw him at large presidential staff meetings, the 25 senior administrators, not the cabinet, the big group, once a month, you know, show and tell. But his leadership style over and over again was that I'm a teacher, I'm an educator, and if I can't teach people what they need to know in order then to make an informed decision, I've let down in my leadership as their president.